Hello students, welcome to EPG Parshala. In this module, we shall be discussing about food chains and food webs. The learning objectives of this module are to learn about food chains and food web in an ecosystem, to understand about grazing and detritus food chains, to learn about different types of food webs, and to understand special features and significance of food chains and food webs. Every ecosystem works in a systematic manner under natural conditions. It receives energy from the sun and passes it to various biotic components. All ecosystems have a feeding hierarchy that starts with the energy source, that is the sun, and then followed by producers, consumers, and decomposers. In grazing food chains and food webs, green plants, that is producers, synthesize food from non-living nutrients with the help of sunlight in the process of photosynthesis. Animals, that are consumers, they consume plants and other animals to get the nutrients and energy. In a detritus food chain or food web, the energy comes from dead organic matter, that is called as detritus, instead of green producers. Therefore, the flow of energy and nutrients take place through food chains and food webs, which becomes the lifeline of ecosystems. What are food chains or what is food chain? The transfer of food energy through a sequence of eating and being eaten by the organisms in an ecosystem is termed as the food chains. Some examples of food chains are given here. The first one is a grassland ecosystem food chain. Here it starts with the grass, then grasshopper, then frog, then snake, and then eagle. The second example is of a forest ecosystem. Forest ecosystem start with a tree, then fruit eating birds, then bigger birds, eagle, etc. The next one is a forest ecosystem food chain. Here it start with plants, then plants are eaten by the deer, and then deer is eaten by the lion. The next one is a pond ecosystem food chain. This start with phytoplanktons. Phytoplanktons are eaten by zooplanktons. Zooplanktons eaten by small fish. Small fish eaten by big fish, and big fish consumed by human beings. The position of organisms along a food chain is referred as a trophic level, and the amount of living matter at each trophic level at a given time is known as standing crop or standing biomass. All the green plants known as primary producers belong to the first trophic level. Plant eaters or herbivores are primary consumers. They belong to the second trophic level, carnivores, or secondary consumers to the third trophic level, and other carnivores or tertiary consumer to the fourth trophic level. The top carnivores in the food chain are known as the top predators. This figure shows that primary producers, then primary consumers, then secondary consumer, then tertiary consumer, and then top predators. This is a food chain of the grassland ecosystem. Energy transfer efficiency limits food chain length. Energy is transferred between trophic levels in the form of food energy when one organism eats another in the ecosystem. There is approximately 80% to 90% loss of energy at each transfer. When energy enters a trophic level, some of it is stored as biomass as part of organism's body mass. As a rule of thumb, only about 10% of energy stored as biomass in one trophic level per unit time ends up stored as biomass in the next trophic level per the same unit time. This is 10% rule of energy transfer in the ecosystem. This table shows different trophic levels and the type of organisms, energy source and examples. In the first trophic level, we have primary producers and source of energy is sun. The examples are tree, plants, algae and phytoplanktons. At second trophic level, we have primary consumers. The source of energy for primary consumers is primary producers. The examples are herbivores like grasshoppers, deer, giraffe, zooplanktons, etc. Then at third trophic level, we have secondary consumers. The source of energy for secondary consumers is primary consumers. And the examples are carnivores like frogs, lizard, crab, wolf, small fish, etc. At fourth trophic level, we have tertiary consumers and the source of energy is secondary consumers. Examples are top carnivores like eagle, tiger, lion, sea otter, big fish, etc. Let we discuss different types of food chains. Let we start with the grazing food chain. The grazing food chain is the major food chain dominantly occurring in ecosystems. The green plants are the primary producer and eaten up by the herbivores, which in turn are eaten up by the carnivores. This food chain doesn't consist of microbes or other decomposer. It is carried out by macroscopic organisms. Let we have a look on the forest ecosystem food chain. This starts with the plants. Plants are eaten up by the deer and deer is eaten up by the tiger. The another example is of grassland ecosystem food chain. Here the grass is eaten by the insects, herbivores. Then insects are eaten by the birds, example sparrow. Then birds are eaten up by the snakes and then snake is eaten up by the hawk. So this is grazing food chain. Second one is detritus food chain. The detritus food chain starts from the dead organic matter such as dead bodies of animals or fallen leaves. Detritus food chain. The detritus food chain starts from the dead organic matter such as dead bodies of animals or fallen leaves, which are eaten by microorganisms and then followed by detritus feeding organisms. They are called as detritivores and their predators. This food chain has the remains of detritus as the major source of energy, and this process gets completed by the subsoil organisms, which can either be macroscopic or microscopic. Thus, these food chains are less dependent on direct solar energy. One example is given here, that leaf litter that is eaten by the bacteria, then bacteria are consumed by the protozoa, protozoa consumed by small fish, and small fish consumed by big fish. The Y-shaped energy flow model further indicates that the two food chains are in fact under natural conditions, not completely isolated from one another. For example, dead bodies of small animals that were once part of grazing food chain become incorporated in the detritus food chain, as do the fecal matter of grazing food animals. The importance of two food chains may differ in different ecosystems. In some cases, grazing is more important and in others, detritus is more important. This figure shows the Y-shaped energy flow model. This is showing linkage between the grazing and detritus food chains. What are food webs? In nature, the food chains never exist as isolated linear sequence. Rather, they are interconnected to form a network called as food. food webs. Therefore, a food web can be defined as a network of food chains interconnected to each other so that a number of options of eating and being eaten are available at each trophic level. This figure shows a simple six-member food web for representative desert grassland. Here you will see that plants are eaten by the ground squirrel as well as by the grasshopper. Then grasshopper may be eaten by the scorpion, and then scorpion may be eaten by the fox. On the other hand, ground squirrel that is feeding on the plants may be eaten up by the fox as well as by the golden eagle. Different types of food webs. Food webs illustrate the links or connections among species in an ecosystem, but these connections may differ in their importance in terms of energy flow and dynamics of species population. Based on how the species influence one another in a community, American geologist Robert Payne, 1980, proposed three types of food webs. First one are connectedness webs. These food webs depict feeding linkage among species in a food web. These are also called as topological food webs. These depict only the presence or absence of a trophic interaction. They, however, don't show the strength of the interaction nor any change in trophic relationship. For the above reason, topological food webs are sometimes referred to as static food webs. Second one are energy flow webs. These energy flow webs quantify energy flow from one species to another. The connections between populations are quantified on the basis of flux of energy between a resource and its consumer. In these food webs, the thickness of an arrow reflects the strength of the relationship. Third one are functional webs or interaction food webs. These food webs represent the importance of each species in maintaining the integrity of a community and reflect influence on the growth rate of other species populations. This figure shows the different types of food webs. First figure represents the connectedness food web, second represent energy food web, and third one represent functional food web. Characteristics of food webs. Reward feedback. Food webs involve much more than who eats whom, an effect known as reward feedback. When a downstream organism in an energy flow has a positive effect on its upstream food supply, say for example, a consumer does something that sustains the survival of its food resource is known as reward feedback. Food webs describe direct and indirect species interactions in a community. All species in the food web are related to each other at different trophic levels. Different organisms may occupy same trophic level. All species in the food webs can be distinguished into basal species, intermediate species, or top predators. Food webs can also be used to illustrate indirect interactions among species. Generally, two types of effects occur when the interactions between two species are influenced by a third species. The effects include trophic cascade, where predators enhance producer growth by feeding on consumer species, and keystone predation, where predators consume dominant competitors thus allowing inferior competitors to persist. Trophic cascade. In a prey-predator relationship, predators can impact both prey abundance and behavior. When the impact of a predator on its prey's ecology trickles down one more feeding level and affects the density and or behavior of the prey's prey, the impact is known as feeding or trophic cascade. This figure shows the trophic cascade in which the predator, that is bird, has a positive effect on the basal species, that is plant, via reduction in the abundance of the herbivore, that is caterpillar. Keystone predation. In the experiment, a variety of mussels, barrancals, limpets and chitons inhibited the rocky intertidal zone. All these invertebrate herbivores are preyed upon by the predator Pisaster starfish. When starfish was removed from the food web, the number of prey species was found to be reduced significantly in that area with the due course of time. Predation by starfish reduced the abundance of mussel and hence supported other species to persist. This type of indirect interaction is called as keystone predation. There are two approaches by which food webs can be used to study the control of community structure: bottom up or top down approach. In bottom up approach, the structure of food webs depicts that productivity and abundance of populations at any given trophic level are controlled by the productivity and abundance of populations in the trophic level below them. For example, plant population densities control the herbivores populations, which in turn control the carnivore populations. In top-down approach, as occurs in trophic cascade interactions, describes the indirect effects of predators. Here the population density of a consumer controls the population of its resource. In a trophic cascade, predator induce effects that cascade down the food chain and affect biomass of organisms at least two links away. What is the significance of food chains and food webs? The food chains and food webs help to understand the feeding relationship and the interactions between different organisms in an ecosystem. Nutrient cycling and energy flow in an ecosystem takes place through food chains and food webs. Food chains keep a check on the population size of different organisms. Food webs are very important in maintaining the stability of an ecosystem in nature. In a linear food chain, if one species become extinct or one species suffer, then the species in the subsequent trophic levels are also affected. Whereas in a food web, there are a number of options available at each trophic level. So if one species is affected, it doesn't affect other trophic levels so seriously. Each species of one ecosystem is kept under a natural check so that the system remains balanced. The study of food chain helps us to understand the problem of biomagnifications. Sometimes certain toxic substances, instead of dispersing, get concentrated at each level in the food chain and are referred to as biological magnification or bioaccumulation. What is biomagnification? Biomagnification or biological magnification refers to the process whereby certain substances such as pesticides or heavy metals become concentrated in successive trophic levels in a food chain. Usually, these substances find their way into lakes, rivers, and the ocean, and then move up in the food chain in progressively greater concentration as they are incorporated into the diet of aquatic organisms such as zooplanktons, which in turn are eaten often by fish, which then may be eaten by bigger fish, that may be eaten by larger birds, or larger birds may be eaten by animals, or animals eaten by human beings. There are two more related terms. These are bioaccumulation and bioconcentration. Bioaccumulation occurs within a trophic level and is said to and is the increase in the concentration of a substance in certain tissues of organisms' bodies due to absorption from food and the environment. While bioconcentration is defined as occurring when uptake from the surrounding environment is greater than excretion. Thus, bioconcentration and bioaccumulation occur within an organism, and biomagnification occurs across trophic levels in a food chain. Dear students, to summarize this module, in this module, we have studied about food chains, about food webs. We also studied about the importance of food chain and about the importance of food webs. We also studied different type of food chains and food webs. And in last, we studied about biomagnification, bioconcentration, and bioaccumulation. Thank you.